Are you ready? Should I? Is this automatic? Should I press this here? Or is already gone?
Just to make sure that green light is.
Alright, so this is our third class, and we'll be moving on to the second chapter a little bit later on today. But I'm going to show you something from the past. And let's see, there's a date here. This is 1995. It's a presentation I gave in 1995 at some conference on management of data. And this presentation has not changed since then. So I think it will be interesting to see what were the thoughts presented then and where we are now. It will give you a very interesting background, I think. So the title is From Data Dirt Roads to InfoCosm. Let's see. And I had just joined University of Georgia. I was in industry before that, as you may know. So this was my first year after I joined University of Georgia. So it kind of reflects on the infrastructure for computing and communication as it was then, and so discusses internet, World Wide Web, electronic commerce, and opportunities due to network computing, how the world may change, and some new challenges in information management broadly, because that is what the audience was. There was one term that was already used in those days, and before I gave this talk, and the term was InfoBahn. So as you know, Bahn is kind of a roadway or railway or something of that nature, and that this is a you know, focus on the fact that a lot of information would be delivered digitally, will travel on the networks. That's what the idea was. And in fact, one of the very popular thing that same year was, I believe, the book, I think, that Bill Gates wrote. I referenced the Road Ahead. Bill Gates. So he had come out with this book then. And the focus, as I saw, was on material or physical objects like geography, distance. How does information transmission, data transmission, provides an alternative to the challenges that are there with regards to the distances. And the challenges, and as you'll see a little bit later on, the challenges had to do, for example, with outsourcing, let us say. So you want to get the software developed here, and the programmers, there happen to be programmers in India. That's a big time difference, right? And much of the implication of InfoBahn or digital superhighway was another, data superhighway or information superhighway was another term that was used. It kind of implied to me of infrastructure, not of the services and applications. And so we talked about high cost of broadband fiber optic networks. There was some in those days and late 90s, there were some companies that were laying fibers, and these were some of the most highly valued companies in the world, as the stock prices and the company valuations go. Also, much of those, much of the writing in those days used to emphasize TV as the user device, not computer. So, I note that, in fact, these are the days where, and I'm talking about common person, not as a computer science graduate student, okay? So computer, I was reading that computer science, computer has been found to be a better starting point. Just the same way, in fact, that inflection is taking place now, where rather than the screens like this, the mobile screen, mobile device screen, and in fact interaction with mobile devices is what is taking or likely to take precedence. So, there were promises of 500 channel TV video on demand and interactive TV. So these were promises and they were not yet taking hold. Right? That is the time we are talking about. So I came across this particular quote: "Information supervisor is an improvised metaphor. It describes only the means of transportation. We need the description of destination of infocosm." There's not much more there. So I took that opportunity to define the term infocosm, and I defined that as a society whose members or organisms can have more effective decision-making capability using information that is available whenever needed, at any place and in many forms. And I think the text is from actually an article I wrote in 1993. Ferguson's thing came about 95, so I think I probably... a world where people will work, learn and play unconstrained by time, place and form. This is what Ferguson said. I think he used that in the word telecosm actually, more than and not just I think it will come in the next. So the point here is that rather than the infrastructure and rather than the connectivity and rather than the network, I wanted to focus on society and its constituents, the people, right? And I think that is that really changes the equation quite a bit. So it's not about delivering the channel, it's about how people participate, it's about how people make get the work done, it's how about people make decision, okay? So that is an important aspect that came about. I'd come across the word telecosm in those days, which was used by George Gilder. Information at fingertips, telepresence, these were some of the terms that were bandied around those days. The components of making these things possible are three in those as I was reviewing: computing, communication, and information. And let's look at some of these interesting, some of the things. The last decade belonged to computing. PC is a $120 billion business. So this is, you know, again very old picture figures. Remember, this was all in 1995. Next decade will belong to communication. Future computing will be network oriented. Analogy is of neural nets, and intelligence will be in the networks. Will not sell and use information, will sell and use information, not data. And another side of impact, because I was giving this presentation in India, and remember in those days, still, you know, we didn't have that much connectivity at all in the developing countries, and not that much penetration of even computers. So then there were, here I have some recap of what's happening in the wireless communication. And the point here was that the communication in the developing countries will not grow through the wired lines. Instead, it will go through wireless. Right? So in those days, it would take... I remember in India it took 5 years to get a telephone line connection after you apply for it. Right? So these were the days. Once the cellular communication came, wireless communication came, you got the connection immediately, right? So there's a huge difference, and it is indeed the case that now, as in US, more people are connected through wireless or cellular plans, right? And this is a capture of a slide and a cartoon or something of sort, a picture, and it shows people in all different venues or situations, and it shows that everybody's carrying along a wireless device. Now, I think that this has come to fruition now in the last few years. So it is also interesting to note what is the lag or how much time it takes from the time that there are visions that are portrayed and the reality. Again, this is a thing that shows a variety of communication computing market sizes. I won't go into detail, that's not very important. And the interesting thing was, here in those days we had a high-speed telecommunication line called ISDN. And internet access was announced. Okay, email available in several cities, and the largest cities had worldwide web access. And that 64 kbps dedicated lines were being made available by satellite. So some of the earliest outsourcing happened over the 64 kbps line. So there were this well-known, there are still today very important IT companies like Infosys and TCS, Tata Consulting Service, and Wipro. They were large by Indian standards, and they acquired these kind of dedicated satellite for 64 kbps line. Think about it, right? Compare that with your cellular lines today. Although US's cellular speed is pretty bad compared to many of the places in the world, including developing countries. So I think the AT&T service that I get is much worse than the service we get in India. And then talks about privatization of telecommunication. In those cases, telecommunication was actually still by the government. And there was a pretty bad stock market in early 90s. This is a picture in Bangalore where the IT has started to boom. Now, this is a portrayal of cyberspace as I saw it those days. I will pass that. Some more details about it. So, you can see the kind of infrastructure services being talked about: payments, billing, collection, security, authentication, whiteboard, groupware, World Wide Web, those kind of stuff. I'll pass that. So, there I was recounting how my trip was organized, and it was pretty new in those days. So if you're trying to, let's say you go to, you're making a trip to Europe, and you are going to three destinations to arrange for the times that work for each of your host and all the stuff, the things had just started to change for somebody like me, and I was telling that to audiences in the developing countries, that look, I was able to arrange this trip much more easily using emails and other some use of web, and FTP was still a big deal, file transfer protocol, we talked about use of Volvo for paper distribution, to get technical papers, complete workshop management, organizing the workshop, publicity for the lab. The LSDIS lab, you can see the logo there, at the University of Georgia. We logged more than 4,000 accesses per week, which was huge in those days. and finding, you know, and I posted direction to my home on the web page, you know, so that's very interesting. There's nothing like maps on the web, right? So I created a PDF file and said you take this left here and right here and 1 mile here and so on and so forth. And this showed penetration of internet 11% in USA and Canada. Right? So we are now, I think, at 80%. 8% used web. Now web and internet is synonym, you know, I mean, I don't think we make any distinction now. But in 1994-95, yes, indeed, there was a big distinction. How people used the internet in those days, access the web, send email, non-interactive discussions, download software, use other computer, interactive discussions, real-time audio and video. Right? So that was what was growing. Also, how people were using it, browse or explore. Now you see here, browsing was bigger than searching. Search for information, products and services, purchase product and services. The interesting thing to note is that, so these were the questions that were asked and answered by people. It reflects on what was the most prominent use of the web. Compare that to the use of the web that you have now. Of course, no Facebook and no Twitter and no social media in those days. So huge change, right? And typically, people in higher earning range, are the ones who had access to the web. And this was some short-term milestone. Focusing on multimedia, that was an area of my interest. So how very specific multimedia related things got done, I'll pass that. And here I'm showing how people are starting to do purchases on the web. Send a gift to a friend or family member anywhere in India. This was started in 1995. Okay. So you can see that. And this was Netscape browser. Reservation request for the thing. This was very new in those days. You see the pages, how they look like. And this was a magazine, Wired 1995. And it had advertisements, and you can see start seeing the links. Adobe had a link, the first page, and so on, so people were publishing that. And this is how people advertise on the physical properties, the cyber properties. Okay. Putting the URLs in real space. Here is a workflow management system that we developed for child immunization tracking in state of Connecticut. So it was a web-based workflow, which was very new, I think probably the first of its kind. Here you can see the work list of the of the people and various kind of web forms that were kind of automatically generated. Electronic commerce, you can see the growth of electronic commerce that was expected. Banking was just starting to come. And how people were trying to utilize web to increase electronic commerce. So Second Corporation, which is now no more, affiliate investment, which is there and strong. So you can see a lot of savings in mailing, handling, printing, electronically delivering prospectus on the web. So prospectus can deliver on the web, and so you can save a lot of money. This is one example. And there's this idea of world PC, or information appliance, another word was browser boy, right? It was talking about this PC to support network computing. Now this was way ahead of netbooks that came out, and there was I think for 2-3 years netbook was something considered to be an important part of the sort of computer market. Suddenly netbook market is gone, disappeared, taken over by tablet and multi-purpose PCs per se, right? And there are still form of netbooks like this Chromebook from Google, right? But the point here was that Java was pretty new in those days, and for programs to run anywhere, and you know, was something quite a novelty. All right, so I kind of a little bit summarized Java there for the audiences. A little bit more on Java. And this was an interesting cartoon in The Economist in 1995. And the cartoon was that Bill Gates is holding on to the PC dearly. And the web is, on the other hand, growing, and the Java is that thing that is creating bigger and bigger web, and taking over more and more things. And so this was a view in early days by some that Microsoft is on the wrong path, trying to hold on to the PC and desktop viewpoint of the computing, and that the internet and web in particular will take over, and will, you know, if Microsoft does not move fast, really make Microsoft very much less important than. So Microsoft was the biggest company in those days, by the way. Right. Talked about market network equalizer, in that it won't take a lot of money to market your software products. Because on the web, everybody can have presence at the same cost, right? Things of that nature. That I then kind of reflected that this can give a very fast catch up to the developing countries. And if you see, what would happen is that this new computing paradigm would lead to diminishing importance of geographic separation and distance, new marketing, sales and support alternatives, so people can build web pages from India, right? New ways to interact with clients and customers, new ways to develop software and provide new software marketplace, new commodity to sell, that is information, selling information. So the knowledge worker was still totally new, alien concept in those days, and that's what I was trying to get to here. You be selling information, which is created by knowledge worker. Knowledge worker creates information. Right? People, if you use text preparation and use web for text preparation, most of them is getting done outside US. It's not getting done here, and so it's many other things. So and that actually happened. As fast as it was envisaged or visioned by me and many others. Exponential growth in capability of computing and communication bandwidth is well documented. And here are things: our ability to represent information and knowledge from numbers and letters to objects and relationships, from syntax to semantics, from transactions to workflow, from data to information, has received less attention, is harder to address, and has lagged, but needs to be done and will be done. That's what I was trying to say there. That's what we are going to actually, also we are going to learn in this course, from syntax to structure to semantics, to some extent. So data versus information is a very fundamental thing. Data is set of facts, while information is application of facts and knowledge of when to use facts. Data measurements about, for example, data is about measurements about real world obtained from human or machine sensors. Information is derivation from facts using cognitive or perceptual processes and such. Right? Information can be used for decision making based on data. So, now last year we had this class on web information system. And actually, earlier when I was at University of Georgia, I used to call class was called Global Information Systems. But the core theme about that class was to talk about this issue, the difficulties in accessing information, the scale issue, vast amount of information, very large number of autonomous sites, which by the way since 1995 has grown exponentially, heterogeneity, Tower of Babel problem, information is presented in many different ways, query expressiveness, the pidgin problem, query language not expressive enough to specify user's interest, it's hard to capture what user is asking for in the syntax of a language. And it is important to notice that in those days, there were only kind of two basic alternatives, either the keyword, because everything was syntax then, and we did not even have search engine by the way, right? You're talking about 1995, or the search engine had kind of around there, but just not on the web per se, or not, you know, scaling. So they're just about getting started. Excite was probably one of the first one. And Alta Vista, as I mentioned last time in the class. And the other thing was SQL. Today, if you think about it, when you do search, there is, on the web, there's a lot of behind-the-scenes natural language processing. There's a lot of language semantics, at least, that is being used in understanding what are you saying. So the computational processes of the search engine are far more sophisticated now than before. And we are going increasingly towards from search to question answer systems. Right? That is what Siri is, right? That is what Google now tries to do. That is what IBM Watson is about. You see? So that we are now at the inflection point about going from leaving the search behind and getting into the question answering thing. Just the same way here, that these were the days where browser was primary thing, search was just starting out. Search has started, I take it back. Search was there, earlier you saw the statistics that there were less than browsing. Some of the approaches that were pointed out that can improve, this is 1995 again, menu-based browsing, hypertext browsing, syntax and section, so information retrieval indexing techniques, name, attribute, and attribute-based search, pattern matching, descriptive symbolic semantics-based search, which is making design assumption explicit and capturing semantics of the query, what the query means, cognitive semantic-based approach, which is pattern a speech recognition algorithm. This is what IBM Watson did, right? This is what Siri does, neural networks. And unattractiveness, challenges with the current techniques for information resource discovery. How do you find the information you want in 1995? So it says, well, you know, navigation browsing, it tends to give, people, users tend to give up if they chase links. After 3-4 links that that they traverse, then they give up. And that you need to be able, you need to annotate the link. What do the links mean? That will reduce the link chasing. this thing has not happened as well as I would have hoped, because in 1996, 1 year after this, I proposed something called MREF, metadata reference link, whereby you would explicitly associate metadata on href, hypertext reference link. That something like that has not yet materialized, and I'm kind of unhappy about it, but that's what it is. Scalability issues, hard to maintain predefined relationships. So when you model size structure or define relationship ahead of the time, that does not help with the information that you want to find, because people have unique needs of information. And then I talked about a couple of projects that we had. One of the first project, one of the earliest projects that I worked on for the web was InfoHarness. So InfoHarness, let me see, I'll show you some screenshots. Started in 1993-94 and it became commercial product in 1995. So in fact, So it was called AdaptX Harness. So a software business house has many things like requirements, design documents, figures, source code, main pages, manual pages, third-party tools. How do you access that all? And so the information was to provide you a new form and integrated access to all these types of information. These are very different kinds of information, right? So for every types of data, we created domain-independent metadata. At some point of time, if you have time, we'll discuss the variety of metadata and how so in the very important role of metadata. So there is a survey paper on that. I won't go into a lot of details there. I now remember there was this thing called Waze. That was a very early tool in finding information on the web, which indexed all the documents. So this was a index system. Okay, not the details of that. You can see this is an Escape browser, and this is a Waze news archive, and you're searching for Kilpatrick. Kilpatrick was, I think, UN secretary or something for US. And you can see the results with the relevance listed on the left-hand side. Those days, the search engines used to give you a number reflecting what it thinks of the relevance. Nowadays, search engines don't do that. And let's look at the second article there. It says, so in this case, what happened is that we can use keyword to search Waze collection, but we cannot provide the semantics author where the keyword is with the keyword Kilpatrick. So I can't tell you that indeed, I can ask the search system that I want those documents for which author is Kilpatrick. How easily you can do today with the search engine? If you are searching Google Scholar, then yes, you can. But if it's a general, any general web page, then
maybe use the term author.
I'm sorry?
Maybe use the term author.
You can use the word author, writer. The web page may have writer. How do you know it's author?
But may give the results because
they. Oh, it may, of course, may. Yeah. But here's the thing: look at this example. You can still get the same results. This is not authored by Kilpatrick. This is a response to the article by Kilpatrick. How do you make that decision? So if or faceted search, right, or key value, right, where author equal to Kilpatrick, that's what you need to say, and the system should have already extracted that. So some of these are not even done today in a broad base. So here is the this was the thing we developed, attribute based search. I think we practically, I think we were the first one to develop attribute search system for the web, as far as I can tell. So this one will say author, you can see here, Kim Patrick. And in fact, I can say, so these are the metadata, these are the attributes for which I extract the corresponding data, which becomes metadata. So attribute-based search access method allows specific semantics like author or date. Right? Now, the results only contain those articles that are authored by Kilpatrick that were posted after 1990, July 1, 1995, because this is greater than, you can see in the submission date, greater than July 1, 1995. And that's exactly what you get. But they're complementary. Keyword and attribute search. So this gives you the architecture and the issue of scalability and how multiple partitions were created and how multiple indexes were created and how parallel indices were searched and so on and so forth. And remember, now this is a picture from 1995. You can see ontologies and user models. So, on the bottom you have a variety of systems that give you information. On the top you have a variety of people you know, who have information needs. And in the middle you have a brokering system that brings people with the need with the people who have it. Or it doesn't have any people, it's systems that have it. But we recognize that there are all the problems with vocabulary, nomenclature, meaning of words, right? These are the challenges that had. So we had ontologies and we had also talked about user models. Remember, think about doing a search on Google with you signed in versus not signed in, right? When you are signed in, Google has access to your user model. Or it's also called profile. Anatomy of information brokering, information resource discovery, query processing, information correlation. So these are some of the things. I won't discuss that in detail today. New challenges in research directions. Semantics is key to information. Context, context, context. Uncertainty, partial information, inconsistency. These have been big problems and they still are unsolved. To a good extent, a lot more work still needs to be done. But the importance of context is very well recognized even today. And a lot of people are working on it. Just, I think maybe last week I shared with the students, I think a panel on context, right? And the context in the, in this case, largely people are talking about context in the use of, you know, mobile devices. How does this device know your context and how does it use to give you what you want? Semantics, what, where? So what is semantics and where you have semantics represented? So, it, you know, you can see here a description there, and again, but you can see here vocabulary plus relationship as ontology. You can see different types of metadata, content independent metadata, content based metadata, and content descriptive metadata. Let me briefly outline these. Content independent metadata. So when you say that this file is 2 GB in size or whatever, then it is it is not based on what actually is said within the file. So it is content independent. Or you say that this file was last modified on this date. Okay, so this does not say, this has anything to do with what is inside the file. So it is content independent. Content based is one where you look at the content of the file, like the words, and you index upon them. So when you say author equal to Kilpatrick, the fact that Kilpatrick appears in the text, that is content based. And if you made association of that word Kilpatrick with the word author, with the notion of author, concept of author, then also that is, and then that is further enhanced form of content based metadata. And content descriptive is, this is a nice picture of a flower. Right? It's your interpretation, it's your description of what it is. Right? It's a through using human cognition process and interpretation of human, right? That is content descriptive. When you tag a picture you upload on Flickr, that is content descriptive, the tag itself. Right? So I showed here, I went to White House server and asked for, I did search on India. And all the results, you can see the results. First result was Navajo and Hopi Indian, American Indian, African American Indian, National Indian, Gaming Condition, all the stuff, right? And very and right here is India PM Rao, Prime Minister Rao. This is the India as in South Asia. But the distinction between the two notions of Indian is not there. How well today's search engines does that for you? Ask this question. Let's say Shreyans, who likes to still monitor some news from India, has been logged into Gmail, and then he does a search on India. Google would use the user model that it has and very likely give high rank to the results of things from India, the country of India. Somebody else who has never had any interest or need to, deal with news on India or whatever, anything to do with India, for that Google would not make that distinction, and rightfully so. But in either case, does Google know that there are two different notions of Indian and Indianness? That answer is rather complicated, to the best of my knowledge right now. Google probably has a very good, or likely in fact has a very good statistical model, which will associate the right India or Indian for you. But until recently, Google did not have the infrastructure for making a direct conceptual distinction between the two Indianness or two India or Indians. And Google is definitely making the progress as it becomes semantic search engine to make those distinctions precisely, because both the concepts of American Indian and India from South Asia are in Google knowledge graph, and consequently the knowledge base that it is going to increasingly use And hence, it has a possibility and potential to do that, although that is not fully used. Yeah. But it is clearly working towards that. Right? Any questions, always, you know, feel free to participate in discussion or questions. So this was one of my favorite projects I ever did, and it's called, you know, the InfoQuilt project was to use metadata patch quilt and user models and ontologies to support information requests over globally distributed heterogeneous multimedia repositories. So here, compared to InfoHarness, which largely focused initially on textual data, later on it had software artifacts like C code and all that you saw in one of the examples. Later on there was a version called Visual Harness, which also brought in images. So there was text and images that it did. InfoQuilt wanted to deal with multimedia objects at semantic level. So you have some breaking story. That story has news article, that story has Wikipedia page, that story has images, so and video and blogs. All these, I want to bring them together through rich set of metadata which utilize this user models and ontologies. So it talks about semantic relationships and other things like that. Here is a illustrative example, one of the prototype implementations of InfoQuilt, where we had on the left you see structured data from US Census Bureau. Then you see structured data in the middle from Tigerline. Tigerline is a very large database, like it gives you county marking and all that stuff, you know, geographical information database. And then you had image data of land cover and elevation, satellite-based data. And then it shows you that you have a query that deals with concepts like population, area, land cover, relief. These are the concepts which are modeling the ontologies. And that using those, it will formulate queries, create subqueries, go to different databases, get the data, combine them, and show the results. So here was interface for being able to ask queries, site location and planning for shopping mall. And the criteria that are used related to land, area of the land, population of the land, land use, and land cover type. Like low density urban area is an example of that. And when you do all the selection, the results will be something like that you see there. And the part in the dark black is the relevant part of the land that satisfies all the constraints in the query that user posed. So even today, this will be a good thing to be able to do. Then we had a project InfoQuilt Observer, ontology-based system enhanced with relationship for vocabulary heterogeneity resolution. That was that is what Observer stands for, by the way. Oh, I'd forgotten that. I'm glad I came back to the slide. Okay. And so this again, 1995 slide, where we have databases, you have ontologies, we have relationships that cross the domains, and queries and query mapping and things of that nature. And I think these are some of the very interesting details, but I'm going to skip today. So the message, and I think this is probably wrapping up. So emerging network computing and increasing importance of communication and the available alternatives are tearing up traditional geographical and market boundaries and giving once in a lifetime opportunity for the developing countries to catch up. They're talking about China and India and Philippines and things of that nature. Use of information, use information to be happy, know how to supply information to be wealthy. And make no mistake, data is not information. These are some of the things. Here are some interesting quotes that I found those days. I think they're still really interesting. Let me read them. By means of electricity, the world of matter has become a great nerve, vibrating thousands of miles in the breathless point of time. The round globe is a vast brain, distinct, instinct with intelligence. And the next one, and this is about connectivity, but the same thing goes to not electricity, but also information. The next one is zooming is when you overcome your fears and trust the universe to make things right. You fly and float and hum and weave and sing. Opportunity knocks. Hello, I like playing with people who zoom. Win-win deals all the time. It's cool. On really cool days, I zoom. So, some interesting things. Anyway. So I guess that's what we have. Right. Any questions, thoughts, comments, anything you want to discuss? Yeah?
I thought it was interesting that you thought paging would exist today.
What will exist?
Paging.
Paging?
Mm-hmm. Pagers.
No, I didn't think it would exist today. Where did I say that?
That was for nothing.
No, it was going down. It was showing you the curve, and the paging was already going down. Do you remember the curve with the three graphs? Cellular, paging, and what is the third one? And I think the paging was already...
PC.
Huh?
PC. Computers.
PCs. Oh, PCs. Yeah, PCs. Yeah, PCs was the third thing. So paging was already going down in 1995. So... But I was just with a doctor friend of mine, and he prefers to use paging.
Still?
Yeah. Because he doesn't want to be, he wants a very limited thing to come to him and decide that, and he wants to deal with it by calling the person back. So, for him, additional information that might come through a smartphone is not useful. He doesn't want to get that. He wants to get that because these guys were trained in the days where before electronic communication was prevalent in a medical field, and they are doctors are touchy feeling kind of guys. They like to talk to the patients, or they try to make that kind of decision. Most of them, with the exception of radiologists, where they don't have any patient connections. Alright, okay then, looks like you're ready for the second chapter talk, so we'll turn over to Sujan and Shivani.
Okay, we are starting with second chapter, the types and models of semantic. I'm dealing with model of semantic. So, before going into detail, I just wanna ask you guys, what is model of semantic? I guess you have gone through the book and the other document. So, any idea about model of semantics? No? Okay. Do you have any? Model of semantic is actually a way to abstract and relate pieces of information. This is model of semantics.
Hey, Sujan. Yeah, please go. You should, and everybody, please start with always chapter 2, and the second slide itself, make sure all the references are given, including the chapter if you got the information from there. So you say that, because remember, somebody on the web who may use this would not have the context of you, the rest of you in the class. So this chapter summarizes, so this presentation summarizes this chapter 2 in this book, and then additional sources you used. And you need to always give credit to the sources of information you use. Always.
Yeah, I mentioned those in the slides.
Okay.
Okay. Here is history of model semantics. The model of semantics was invented by U.S. Air Force in mid 1970s. They first found it, they were working actually on the integrated computer-aided manufacturing. I took this information from Wikipedia. So it says that ICANN program actually developed some techniques to deal with the model of semantics since it was very new that time. So developed some techniques to deal with model of semantics. I have mentioned some techniques over there, but they are not in detail. So you can go through the Wikipedia and get the details. The application of model semantics. Model semantics can be used for many purposes. Some of them are here: the planning of data resources, building of shareable databases, evaluation of vendor software, integration of existing databases. All these are from Wikipedia itself. So you can go there and take a detail of it. It is just just overview of the. Okay, here is the model. I took these two types of, there are only two types of models. Those two models are from book. The first one of them is a prescriptive approach. Prescriptive approach is all about the specification of formal semantics of symbol from scratch. It basically deals all the, way of symbols to include the content of semantics. There are only two types. That prescriptive one deals with the unambiguous one, and the equation reasoning or axiomatic one.
Can you stop? So you guys.
Anyway, I wrote some notes about it, but I'm not able to see my notes besides this slide. It's ambiguous one. You can easily.
So you have a if you want.
Yeah, it's ambiguous conceptual relationship of.
So yeah, these are your notes. But now, how are you going to do that? I don't know.
Leave that itself. Okay, ambiguous is clearly with its name, it's saying that it is not so clear. It's ambiguous in nature. And the other one is equation reasoning or axiomatic. I'm not going much detail of this because we have very less time with the other types of semantics. Logics for prescriptive semantics. There are a few logics we are dealing with by working with prescriptive semantics. Some of them are first order logic and model logic. First order logic has three subtypes: the formula, Boolean operator. It deals with Boolean operator like AND, OR, like that, NOT, and quantifiers. Model logics are possibility and necessity. It's still about possibility and necessity. In my slide, it is available in the notes section. You can go through it. It's not visible to me, so I can't, go through it right now. But the definition of both are available. It's just a small example of first order logic. Like while going through the book, I find some example like for RDF and XML. It shows the relationship between the two. The first example for XML was the son and mother relationship. How it shows the relationship between two entities in a form of language. So XML was in a book. I just got this example from Wikipedia for the first order logic. It shows relationship between philosopher and scholar. It shows like this way, in this way. So all details are in the slide, so I'm not going much detail. So other logics are for prescriptive semantics are Horn logic and logical programming. Horn logic serves the foundation of the logical programming languages, and descriptive logic, web ontology language are the other forms of logics of prescriptive semantics. Web ontology language are the, you know, basics, like it's FOL, first order language is the language of family restricted ontology, sorry, OWL is the family of FOL and more expressive than propositional logic. OWL is knowledge of presentation. Other model is the second model, is descriptive approach. It serves the, it's trying to capture the contemporary terms and samples of to promote consensus on the topic, but depending upon the topic, it can change. Like if a person is working in some other domain and the another one is working in different domain, then their consensus might vary. So in that case, like depending upon the domain or user context, the consensus may vary. If you are belonging to same domain, then it's basic approach to come together on the same point. The different form of descriptive approaches are extensible markup language, XML, and XML schema, entity relationship model. I hope you know all these, ERM and UML, unified modeling language. Linked open data, LOD. LOD provides an approach to publishing structured data in a form that is conducive to their consumption. Ontology. I guess Professor Said told us that he will go in detail of ontology, but it's a little effort of mine to describe some ontology. What is ontology? I went through the book and got this thing that ontology is basically a vocabulary or semantics to discuss things with a common language. To using that we can share with people rather than going various local languages. So like ER diagram says a lot of stuff, but when you say ER diagram, it's automatically very easy to locate that, oh, ER diagram relates with entity relationship diagram. You don't you need not have to go for in detail that how it works and all. So you can say ER diagram and you can move ahead. W3 standard language for ontology are called RDF. So basically ontology needs a media to show how it works. So different languages, it needs some different languages to get into detail, like how it works, and it easy for people also to understand. Some of those languages are RDF, that is Resource Description Framework, and OWL, Web Ontology Language, individual. There are some types. I got it from Top Quadrant. The ontologies include individual, classes, properties. It's all in detail, individual data objects such as Top Quadrant. It's like referring to, addressing to individual classes. These are the set of individuals that have some common characters such as country. Some might have belonged to same country or state. It's like that. And properties. Model semantic. Okay, that's all. We are moving towards types of semantic. So, Sujan.
I don't think we have time for that.
Yeah, but you can. Your wish.
I can. Yeah.
Then we stay.
Okay.
That was a fun. Okay, so
guys, in future though, when you give the presentation, you need to have a mastery of what you're presenting, and make sure you are able to at least remember and give the examples of what you're saying. Just saying here some words is not going to do any good to anybody.
Yeah, so I'm just trying to think of the first part of the chapter is talking about types of semantics. So basically, what does type of semantic means to me is like, so if you consider computer science algorithms and all the working areas and all these things, everybody who are working with data and all these things experts some sort of semantics. And here, it tries to summarize, like categorize these into three categories and try to present applications and usage of these semantics. With examples. So I always try to give concrete examples here. So let's try to understand what these three semantics means. This is a RDF data graph. If you are not very familiar with RDF, think about this as all these boxes. The blue boxes are entities which are represented with URLs to just to give a unique identifier. And all these yellow boxes are values like literals. And this the entities will have links named direct links. So this is a basic RDF data structure. Here, even though you don't have good idea about what these entities are, you might be able to say, yeah, these two seems to be related because it has same URL pattern and both of them have outgoing links which are labeled with likes and like have type relationship and which has same literal value, something like that, right? So basically you might be able to say these two have some relationship. So here we are exploiting what we call implicit semantics. All machine learning algorithms and all those things, majority of them are basically try to exploit this implicit semantics and try to classify clustering and all these things. So even though at this level you can't do much with semantics because it does not give you good semantics here. So this is like the typical problem that if you know like the LOD community face, they don't have a rich schema or they just have a very shallow schema. You can't do much with this. So the next step is to give the schema for this one. There are like automated ways to derive this schema. Maybe not as precise as this, but to do this you might need somebody actual person to work on that. So here I'm trying to develop the schema for this data set. See here, like these two things I categorize as student, which is the entity. So all these gray circles are classes, and these are individuals, like what do you call it? If you're familiar with programming, just these are variables and these are classes kind of things. So these two are type, like mean these are two students, and by adding more semantics here, I'm saying student is a type of person. So these things are coming from a standard language called RDF and RDFS. Furthermore, I'm categorizing these two individuals to poses, which is again a class, and it has a equivalent relationship with some other class. So that particular term coming from a language called web ontology language, OWL. Now actually here in this schema I have formal semantics. What I mean by that is you can do some reasoning here. These semantics are backed by models, model theory semantics, where they define all these things very formally, and they can develop reasoners to exploit the semantics and derive implicit knowledge. So here, for example, I can say, since these two individuals are student, and student is a class of person, these two things are person also. So that's kind of implicit things that I'm trying to derive. And here, since these two particular individuals are course, and then course is equal to class in some other schema, okay, and these two must be class two because that is equal. So the semantics of subclass of type and equivalent class are defined in a very formal way, so that doesn't matter where you apply, if you can represent your data according to these terms, you can run these reasoners and derive your knowledge. So at this moment we exploit implicit semantics and formal. And here you can see this particular student likes two classes, like Web 3.0 and information retrieval. That's what I mean by IR. But still, this particular data set does not say what class he mostly liked. Like, what is the favorable one among these two, right? So that semantics is not here. But that is what it refers as powerful semantics. What is the, whether this student most likely this one or that one. So we can, that semantics is not represented here. And still, people are not very capable of exploiting such semantics to derive what they do with formal semantics. They can't do much stuff with that. And even though you did that, it's going to be very specific to your domain and maybe the data set too. Yeah.
You said that you can't determine how much it, like, or one entity likes either the other ones. Are there ways to do that?
Yeah, you can, like, you may be able to not this particular relationship like, but for other relations. I mean, I may be able to talk about that in later slides. But depending on your data set, and depending on your domain, and depending on your knowledge, you may be able to say that this like is more, let's say you have some degree like 1 to 10, this is 10, and this is 5 like that. Still, there are like techniques, like if I use the term verification, you can still represent these things. But people are not able to exploit these things to do magic like they do with this. So that's the thing. And as per Dr. Seth Wiesman and the papers and all these things, that is the most powerful semantics that you can use to enhance the semantic web or enhance any algorithm.
We can stop here and continue next time. But did you guys get it?
Semantics is to get some meaning out of data or out of something. So I mean, why do we categorize this semantics? What do we get?
Because there are so many different techniques and tools to represent, and computationally process these things, right? So you have Horn clauses, first order logic, you have description logics, you have probabilistic logic of various kinds, you have fuzzy logic, you have other things. So all these have pros and cons, the word semantics is used in many, many broad ways, even different ways than what Sujan only presented one particular way of characterizing it. There are other categories. I can say semantics is discussed in language theory or linguistic semantics. Semantics as used in natural language processing, very different. Semantics as is used in knowledge representation, semantics as is used in information retrieval. Each of these communities have different interpretation use of semantics. At the bare minimum though, right now, we want to be able to talk about semantics as in what are the different methods and corresponding representation formalisms to associate meaning with data on the web. That's our core focus. So we have this data on the web, we have all these web documents, web pages. We have all the structured data and deep web data. We have directories and dictionaries on the web. We have link open data. We have large structured databases, let's say in biology and many other cases. Well, what different forms of processing are we going to do? So even just starting with the search example, when you type in a keyword, and Google gives you rank set of documents. How did it represents the data for trying to match the meaning of the documents or contain the documents that is closest to the keywords you type? For example, you type best park in America. It's very first of all, not well defined. It's, you know, it's hard to say what do you mean by best. And how would search engine itself represents what you say? And then how would it compute about it? How would it compute about it? For example, if I interpret this query, best park in America or best park in New York, it will likely be, a traditional approach would be to process with regards to the use of word best in the text. So many, you know, some people would have, somebody would have write review. Some person would have write review saying best park in United States. And the system will be able to find that for you without necessarily understanding best, and that somebody else might have said greatest park ever or most enjoyable park. Is that the best? I don't know. Would such engine understand that? No. On the other hand, suppose you start getting into the structured knowledge base representation. Let's say eventually some form of Google knowledge base may, not only Google knowledge base, because it is still very limited form of knowledge representation as of now, but eventually it may start representing the fact, because Amit Singhal talks about relationship, the vice president of Google, you know, so I think they do now understand, and they are intent upon exploiting the relationship aspect of the things. So the relationship, then suppose there is explicit relationship between best and most enjoyable. And you start representing that. Now, you're going to represent the information a little differently, in a more structured form, and possibly more formally, because you can say that this is same as. If the moment that that relationship can be used and explored in a formal representation for soft semantics. While the earlier example of you know, match based on the textual common use of what is words like best in somebody's blog item, that is implicit. That, oh, it looks like it may, you know, there's a statistical match, it looks like they mean the same thing. They have used same pattern of word usage. So what our objective here is to try and distinguish between the different representation and corresponding computation, formalism and computations for the semantics as pertaining to the data on the web, and particularly Web 3.0. Right? So that's what we are trying to do. All right, so it looks like we'll end it here right now and continue in the next class.